My patient is Mr. X, 34-year-old gentleman, resident of Bihar, tea vendor by occupation, presented to surgical OPD with chief complaints of swelling in front of the neck for 3 months. He was apparently normal 3 months back when his family members noticed a swelling in front of neck, which was insidious in onset and gradually increasing in size. It was initially of size 1 into 1 centimeter, which gradually increased to current size of 3 into 3 centimeter, and there are no aggravating factors. There is no history of pain or the swelling. There is no history of fever, chills, loss of weight or appetite. There is no history of cough or expectoration. No symptoms suggestive of hyper or hypothyroidism. No history of trauma to the neck. No history of change of voice or breathlessness or difficulty in swallowing. Past history, there is no history of surgeries in the neck area and no history of tuberculosis in past. No history of exposure to any radiation. No history of any medication for any chronic ailments. Personal history. Patient is non-vegetarian by diet and consumes iodized salt, and he consumes cabbage occasionally once in a month, and he is not alcoholic and not smoker. He is having normal appetite, and sleep and appetite are normal. Bowel and bladder habits are normal. He is married and has 3 healthy children. Coming to family history, there is no history of similar complaints in any of his family members, and there is no history of malignancies in family. Summary. A 34-year gentleman hailing from Bihar, presenting with painless swelling in front of neck for 3 months, insidious in onset, gradually progressing in size, with no symptoms suggestive of hyper or hypothyroidism or constitutional symptoms or compressive symptoms, and without any significant past personal and family history.
Trauma to the neck, why?
It may be...
What is your case?
Solitary thyroid nodule.
Thyroid related. So don't complicate it unnecessarily. Same thing in the breast, they keep harping on fat necrosis, trauma. Unless, and plus it is not there. So there's no point bringing it in. It doesn't really add much. I think they will have something to ask. Any question? Is that what you're saying? In the history also. History, were there any features?
No, sir.
So you answer by saying points in history and points on examination.
Yes,
points in history, none. Yes, which points you were looking for?
History of, for hyperthyroidism, sir, episodes of anxiety, palpitations, sweating, intolerance to heat, and...
On examination, what did you find? Did you look for eye signs and...
Yes,
you looked for them?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I won't ask you that because they'll have some questions to ask. Yes, yes, sir.
In a thyroid case, you must always mention that you examined the lower limb, right? And you...
So we should look for pre-table mixed edema to
it has to be done. And look for proximal muscle weakness.
Myopathy.
Both of them have been missed here.
Which are these muscles he's talking about?
Sir, proximal muscles of like arm and...
You can take that mic.
Can you go back to your slides and show us if you have written whether the rest of the thyroid was palpable or not? Have you mentioned it anywhere, if the rest of the thyroid was palpable or not palpable?
It was not palpable.
Have you written it?
No.
Did you speak it? You did not. Have you written anywhere or told us that no lymph node was palpable in the neck? It's a thyroid case. These are two extremely important findings in regional examination that should have been taken care of. What is a dominant nodule?
I'll request Professor Srivastava to join us now. You went somewhere in between.
Oh, we have a chair.
You carry on, please.
What is a dominant nodule and what is a solitary nodule?
Ma'am, when there is a diffuse enlargement of the thyroid with the palpable nodule, then it is called as dominant nodule. When we can only palpate the nodule and the rest of the gland is not palpable, then it is called solitary thyroid nodule.
Right. If it is not palpable, the rest is not palpable.
And in the history also, you could have specifically taken whether there is any history of fluctuation in the size of nodule or not. Can you tell us some swellings that may increase and decrease in size?
Swelling can increase in size with...
Asking you, can there be a swelling which will sometimes increase and then thereafter decrease also in size and can increase again?
Other than thyroid, ma'am, or
no, in the thyroid only.
Thyroid. With hemorrhage, any colloid goiter cyst can.
Hemorrhage will cause sudden increase in size. Yes.
And so how would it reduce later on? What she's asking you is, can there be a swelling which is of thyroid that fluctuates in size?
If there is a solid nodule which undergoes necrosis and then it can reduce.
So that gradually leads to increase only. Autoimmune thyroiditis has to be kept in mind in such cases.
What is a solid thyroid nodule? Define it. You defined it already, but we add it, so now we can make it into a diagnosis or definition. What is a solid thyroid nodule, therefore? Based on what you heard just now?
Yes, sir. Enlarged thyroid nodule, palpable thyroid
only
nodule.
Only palpable nodule with the rest of the gland not being
palpable.
If it is palpable, palpable gland is taken as pathological. Then it becomes a multinodular goiter, correct?
Yes.
And you said it's clinically euthyroid and probably benign. Why do you say it is benign?
Sir,
you did not mention about the lymph node in the neck as they were asking you. But that would be necessary. Because if the lymph node in the neck is palpable, you would suspect it to be
malignant.
Therefore, the examination of the neck remains just the same as in the previous session. You don't have to change it. Yes, somebody was saying something. Yeah, quick.
You said there are macules. What is a macule?
Sir, macule is a hypopigmented or depigmented flat lesion of less than 1 centimeter size. If it is more than 1 centimeter, it's called patch.
Now, suppose it's a swelling which is only a part of the gland, part of the lobe. Suppose whole of the lobe is enlarged. Will it still be taken as a solitary nodule or not?
Yes, sir. It can be taken as a solitary thyroid nodule if rest of the gland is not palpable.
Can be, it should be.
Yes,
there should not be like can or...
The definition is clear.
Yes.
If you palpate the remaining gland, it will become multinodular goiter. It's just a nodule that you should talk about.
Is that right?
Yes.
And don't use terms like moves up and down on deglutition. These are loose terms. If you hear them around, it only moves up on deglutition because naturally it cannot move down. And some people would be, I'm glad you did not mention that, movement on protrusion of tongue. which is not relevant here. Why do you think it is not relevant here?
Sir, it should be checked only in small swellings in midline with, at superior part of the
superior
neck.
Part. So you should not be even mentioning it. Because if you can you tell us how do you examine for that?
Sir, we show the patient like how it is done. We explain the procedure. And we
now that reminds me, when you started, you mentioned correctly that I examined a patient in a good daylight in a sitting position with me sitting in front.
In front of the patient.
An inspection was done from front. You mentioned the swelling is in the thyroid fossa. What are the boundaries of this thyroid fossa? This is the other thing you will tell me. Tell me the first one.
We ask the patient to wide open his mouth, opening his jaws completely, and ask the patient to put the tongue.
You will only ask the patient to do everything, right? First, demonstrate to the patient. How do you demonstrate? The jaw should remain open and the tongue has to go out and in. And with that, the swelling, you inspect from the lateral side. What happens to the neck?
Neck should be in extended position, sir.
Why should we extend it?
To make the track of thyroglossal duct.
The coil track straightens up and the visibility also improves. You should be able to see also, no? And there's something else that happens. If the swelling is large, floor of the mouth can restrict it. If your neck is down, it can restrict its movement upwards. So you need to extend it. Now the second, the thyroid fossa, you said.
Thyroid fossa, sir, it is... boundaries of thyroid fossa are inferiorly suprasternal notch, superiorly thyroid cartilage, and laterally by the anterobod of sternocleidomastoid.
On both sides?
On both sides.
So you can safely say there is a swelling in the thyroid fossa or in the region of thyroid, rather than saying in front and behind and otherwise. And most of the examination is done, inspection from front and palpation from behind, except for trachea, which you didn't mention. How about trachea? How did you look for whether it's deviated or not?
Sir, on inspection, we can look for position of trachea by looking at the prominence of sternocleidomastoid.
What is this called?
Trail sign.
Trail sign, okay. You look for prominence. What do you do next?
Then in palpation, we should do three-finger test where we keep index finger and ring finger on the sternocleidal joint and we palpate the length of the trachea and also look for the gap between the trachea and the sternocleidomastoid if it is
okay.
Different on
the inside. How do you proceed now? Any questions, Suhani? Any points? How do you proceed now?
Sir, I will do quadruple assessment in this patient.
What is quadruple?
Sir, it includes history and examination, clinical examination, and ultrasound neck, thyroid function test, and biopsy.
Well, this is the advantage of first watching the previous presentations on the YouTube and coming, right? But still give him a round of applause. At least he came prepared. But this is all our YouTube, the previous scope cases. But good, you should know that. Now, triple test is what we normally do. What is that?
Clinical exam, history and clinical examination, thyroid function test and ultrasound.
Why, which thyroid function test? You're not right actually.
Yes, sorry. Clinical history and clinical examination, ultrasound and biopsy.
FNAC.
FNAC.
We don't use the word biopsy, is tissue diagnosis. No? Cytology is cells. Okay, so which thyroid function test?
TSH is...
Why?
Sir, if it is normal, then we need not to do T3, free T3 and T4 levels. And if it is...
No, you've done TSH before FNAC. Why is it necessary?
Sir, we have to rule out thyrotoxicosis or hyperthyroid.
If it is a toxic one, what do you do?
We need not to do FNAC. We should...
Need not to do or you should not do?
Should not do.
Why?
Like, it will aggravate the...
Need not is also correct. Why need not?
Sir, we don't gain anything from doing FNAC. Like most of the malignancies, like which we want to diagnose, they will be not functioning. And
what percentage are functioning?
We may precipitate thyroid storm.
What percentage are functioning? Anybody shout? No, not 30%. 10%. So you would get it in rare. If you have a toxic gland, it's unlikely to be malignant. That's what you're saying. And what is the second reason why you shouldn't do it? Thyroid storm. Any third reason? False positives due to?
Hyperplastic changes because of...
So you would have the hyperplastic changes which may confuse the cytologist with a false positive that you can give. Okay, you. And what do you do for the imaging? You said, you didn't say imaging, that's why I'm adding.
Ultrasound neck I will do.
How do you stage? What system is used for?
Thyroid is used.
Thyroid. What are the stages? You know about the grades? What are those? Thyroid 1, 2, 3. Since you're presenting a thyroid case, you would have come prepared. Yes. And you watched that YouTube video. It is there in that discussion. So what is it?
Thyroid Thyroid 1 is benign, sir, and thyroid 2 is probably benign. Thyroid 2 is minimum suspicion of malignancy.
What is that suspicion? How do you an ultrasound suspect?
Sir, we look for composition, shape, echogenicity, echogenic foci and margins.
Correct. So what do you see in that?
Sir, in composition we look for like, is it cystic or solid? Or it is solid cystic, and in
heteroechoic or yes, okay.
In echogenicity, we see it is hyperechoic, isoechoic, or hypoechoic.
Taller than wide. You look for that here, no? Taller than wide is more suspicious. Well, that's theoretical, so we'll not go there. So you've done a thyroid test, and you've done a triple. What is the fourth part you said of quadruple?
Biopsy. If any.
So that is three. One, two, three. History and clinical examination. Imaging using ultrasound and FNAC. That is triple. What is the fourth one? Should have watched it carefully. Genetic testing for what? BRAF mutation. Necessary?
Yes, sir.
Like, how does it help?
Sir, to assess the prognosis of the patient, like
how?
BRAF mutation is associated with.
Somebody can shout. It's mostly radioactive iodine resistant. Prognosis is poor. Grade is poor. So that's the fourth one, which has been recommended by ATA, American Thyroid Association, but not mandatory. Triple test is done. Proceed. What do you do now? You've done the investigation. And in the clinical examination itself, you mentioned indirect laryngoscopy. That was for the oral cancers that we were talking, that you can do an office procedure of indirect laryngoscopy to look for synchronous lesions. But here we normally get it done. Why do you want to get an IDL done?
Sir, to look for vocal cord paralysis, which is not symptomatic, and to document it,
To document it, and what is recommended now? It's IDL alone or something more? Anybody? Voice quality assessment studies, because even with a normal cord, the voice could be bad. And post-operatively, the patient can sue you that my voice was better than this. So they record it now before they do surgery for thyroid. And then they get it afterwards. Okay? Now, I have brought you this far. Any questions regarding the treatment now? Quickly. Anybody? Please take the call. Anybody?
Any importance of calcification in the region of thyroid?
Yes, ma'am. In palpation, like if it is calcified thyroid nodule, we feel it as
an imaging. You can see
on ultrasound or an imaging.
Ultrasound, ma'am, macro calcification is
features
more
of
benign. And,
macro is benign. Micro is feature of
malignancy.
Which one?
Speckled micro calcification or
which malignancy?
Papillary. Okay. They answered that, so we skip it. How do you manage this case,
sir? Based on FNAC findings, I will.
FNAC is papillary carcinoma thyroid. You bought
then,
it, so
yes.
The answer is correct.
Then I will stratify the patient into low risk or high risk.
How do you stratify the patient into low and high risk?
I will, he's a young patient and...
What is the cutoff for age? 45 was for males or for females?
For females, 55 was for males.
50 for females, 45 for males. Females get it more often, but males get a worse cancer. That's what is said. Okay. Now, risk stratification you've done. How do you do that, finally?
So
papillary, risk stratification done. It falls into low risk.
Then if falls into low risk, I will do lobectomy. And
what is lobectomy?
So removal of one side lobe with isthmus.
No, there's no lobectomy is a term that is used in some of the books, but lobectomy is not the correct term. What is the minimum biopsy?
Hemithyroidectomy.
So hemithyroidectomy is the other. Lobe plus the isthmus. You don't remove just the lobe. If you remove only the lobe, it will be an incomplete job. So lobe plus isthmus and sometimes a part of the opposite side. Yes, Dr. Swani. Any question? Pass the mic to her.
This was a papillary carcinoma thyroid, 3 cm nodule, 45 years of age. Coming from residing in Bihar, what are the options that you can consider for surgery, clinically and zero, clinically and ultrasound?
Hemithyroidectomy.
Okay. What is the advantage of doing a hemithyroidectomy?
Patient will need not a patient will not be needing levothyroxine throughout his life in post-op period, and chances of hypoparathyroidism are less as we are not dissecting on the opposite side. And
okay, what are the problems in doing HEMI? HEMI is easier, and it is usually recommended to surgeons who don't practice thyroid surgery regularly. A lot of people would like to do total. So what would be the argument against
problem
HEMI?
With HEMI thyroidectomy, sir, we can miss microcarcinomas in opposite lobe.
Okay.
And problem of doing next surgery on recurrence is very difficult. And yeah, chances of injury to the parathyroid and recurrent laryngeal nerve will increase.
If you go back second time, what else?
And we can't give, we need to use a high dose of radioactive iodine if you want to ablate the...
That is not an option. So what else is the disadvantage? Anybody, HEMI versus total? Anything to do with the follow-up? I'm giving you a hint.
Thyroglobulin levels may not be useful. And
loudly? Scan. So you can follow up these patients better. That's the argument. What those, I agree with you, low risk, you can offer hemithyroidectomy. There's nothing wrong in it. But those who will ask you why, we do total, why? So they give this reason. Now why this is not a very palatable reason to a lot of people is that this contralateral microcarcinomas or the laboratory cancers, they're called laboratory cancers. They may not grow into frank, big cancers. So there is no point knocking that off. And the second thing is this concept of, second time surgery would be a problem is not acceptable because you'll go only on that side. So that's not a problem. Radioactive iodine to knock off the complete lobe is not an option, that I agree. But the disadvantage is you can't follow up these patients. But you know, papillary does so well with or without treatment, the outcome is very good. What is the survival rates like?
20-year survival rate is more than...
So you're talking in terms of 20-year survival, so you don't necessarily need to cause damage. So they have devised a formula now for the benefit of postgraduates in US. They do benchmarking of the surgeons, where those who do high volume, they can do total, and the others will do less than total. They have defined it. So you cannot do it just like that. It may cause problems. There are a lot of people who would like to do even central neck dissection at the same time. But that is for tumors that are more than 4 centimeters. So she said 3, which is a cutoff that we gave. 4 and less than 4, more than 4, and less than 1. That is how they look at it.
So if you go by the ATA risk stratification, anyways for low risk tumors, you'll not need a routine thyroglobulin? Or do you need it?
I did not get it.
Sorry?
I did not understand the question.
You didn't understand the question. The question
is, this logic about which I gave you the other group, about thyroglobulin is not necessary, you don't need to follow up. What precisely, what she's trying to say is the same thing that we said, patient is living long enough and you don't need to follow it up with thyroglobulin. That's, and the other, there's another problem, this preserved, for those who do thyroid regularly, the preserved lobe may not be functioning. A lot of them get into hypothyroid state subsequently. So a lot of people have an argument against it. But the four arguments are that thyroglobulin you don't need. You don't need that kind of a rigorous follow-up. You can ask Dr. Soni. I clarified the question. Do you know about it?
I just wanted to clarify that HEMI versus total, neither is right, neither is wrong, but you should understand what you are saying. You need to understand it clearly. If you are saying HEMI, so there is less risk of post-operative hypocalcemia and permanent hypothyroidism. The oncological outcome is not different from a total thyroidectomy. The microcarcinomas may never manifest. And in low-risk patients, there is no need to do a routine thyroglobulin and a routine scan in the follow-up. Okay, so the risk stratification also came once it was known that the 10-year and the 20-year follow-up was not difference between HEMI and the total. So you can do a hemithyroidectomy. The proponents of total thyroidectomy as discussed are that, okay, you can use, they are the conventional ones, that papillaries can be multi in both lobes, so it is better that you...
The part that you already answered, right?
So this, the reason you need to know...
Should be clear on in your mind. And don't say one thing, but you can say either and defend yourself. The question will be asked either. When you say total, why not HEMI? When you say HEMI, why not total? And don't use the term lobectomy. It's used loosely in US books mainly. Lobectomy is no term anymore. And there's nothing like partial thyroidectomy. And absolutely nothing like subtotal thyroidectomy. Subtotal thyroidectomy is completely obsolete. If somebody is still asking you, don't fight with him on that day. Deal with him later. On that day, you agree. Sir, subtotal, what a surgery. Perfect. I'll fail if I find it. Because this is a surgery which means nothing to nobody. It has no definition. What is total thyroidectomy, etc.? We have two more cases of thyroid to discuss. With that, we conclude this case, should we?
And this was a 3 centimeter nodule and came as an
benign colloid nodule. Okay.
So what will you do next in terms of management?
Sir, ma'am, I will. If patient is euthyroid, I will aspirate the.
This is your case. It is colloid.
Yes. Sir,
it's a colloid.
I will.
Would you aspirate a goiter?
No. Sir. I will start treating for hypothyroidism.
The patient is euthyroid, benign, 3 centimeters. Colloid goiter. I have told you.
I will ask her to follow up, ma'am.
How will you follow up?
Ultrasound neck every 6 months. And
you know the answer? When you don't know, say I don't know.
Ma'am, 50% of colloid goiters subside.
No, that is okay, but you said you will follow up. How will you follow up? How patient ultrasound and what are you looking on the ultrasound to change to intervene?
If size of the goiter, colloid goiter increases and.
Look, 3 centimeter, you can leave it alone, provided the patient is not insisting or it's not cosmetically disfiguring. A lot of answers come for this. Okay. And the difference between a regular follow-up and surveillance is that you'll investigate also. Intervention will be involved. Okay? So don't use the term loosely. Follow-up means she comes, says hello, goes back. You examine clinically. Ultrasound is an extension of any thyroid surgery. We do our own ultrasounds, it's possible to do. What changes would make you suspect it's getting worse? Is that what she was asking? Try to understand a question. Sometimes it may not be put the way you want it. So, what is it that you're looking for that will make you suspect it's not good? Obviously, the changes that you will.
You get an FNAC done, and FNAC shows lymphoid tissue with some thyroid rests in it. How will you interpret this report? Solitary thyroid nodule, FNA done, which shows lymph node tissue or lymphatic tissue with some thyroid rests in it.
Ma'am, it may be a metastatic.
Yes, it has to be interpreted as a metastatic disease.
Clear? So, what percentage of STNs are malignant actually? I just because she asked you, though, I thought. Are they mostly malignant or benign?
Benign, sir. 80% are colloid.
So look at whatever causes, whatever features would indicate that there is a change towards malignancy. So, in your surveillance, when the patient is coming, you'll have ultrasound features, history, patient may develop hoarseness, which is persistently increasing, etc. We'll have another thyroid case. Sir.
Now, suppose this is a follicular neoplasm in your FNAC. What is your next?
Minimum biopsy to be taken is hemithyroidectomy. And based on frozen section, I will proceed like if it turns to be benign, I will close the incision. And if it turns to be having features of invasion, vascular and capsular invasion, I will do completion thyroidectomy on the same setting.
In fact, frozen, you cannot rely on.
Redo surgery after 8 weeks. Or
so you can do it in a second setting, yes. Based on the histopathology report, which is very important. Sometimes frozen negative can turn out to be histopathology report. So you need to be careful. In frozen, when we use the term frozen,
be careful. A lot of time the tissues don't freeze and you cannot do it, even breast also. So it's not 100%. But frozen started with follicular only because you couldn't mention whether it's malignant or not. All right. Although ultrasound today is considered extremely, I was doing a panel discussion on this, and the radiology showed features where you don't need an FNA and it can tell you it's malignant. Ultrasound is a very sensitive test in thyroid today. Rather than FNAC, you can find out, no, this is not the follicular you're looking at. Therefore, these terminologies have also disappeared. Variants now they're called. Thank you. Give a round of applause, please.
Thank you, sir.